You are listening to the Alouettes Flight Deck, a proud member of the Canadian Football Podcast Network.
All right, folks, we've been cleared for takeoff.
I'm gonna be iconic.
Yeah!
And welcome to the Alouettes Flight Deck podcast dedicated to Montreal Alouettes football. I am Tim Capper. You can find me on X at Repact. That's R-E-P-P-A-C-T.
And I'm Cliffy D. You can also find me on X over at Cliffy D.
And we can't forget to thank our presenting sponsor, the guys over at SportBuff, where if you go and use the promo code AlouettesFlightDeck10 at checkout, you will save 10% off your entire order. So head over to sportbuffshop.com. Save 10%, buy merch from many of the leagues that they do offer, including Team Canada stuff, a lot of new Team Canada stuff, actually. Save the money and support local.
Yes, definitely. I'm glad you mentioned all the Team Canada stuff with the Olympics coming up the next couple weeks. What better way to get your swag than using our promo code and heading over to Sport Buff Shop? So do that. And yes, as always, support local.
It was the Olympics, the Copa. Was it Copa? That they just got eliminated from today?
Yeah, Copa, but no cigar.
Yeah, you go. Cope, but no, yeah. But they still play third place. So I did not know that. I learn new things every day when it comes to...
Yeah, what I know about soccer, unfortunately, can fit into a thimble. So I'm like, hey, good on them. I mean, you know, obviously as a proud Canadian, I'm happy for that. But I'm sorry. I'm so into football. Like, football, not football. Soccer. It's called soccer.
It is.
Here it does, where God pays attention. Soccer.
Supposedly, and please correct me if I'm wrong, and again, I don't believe everything you see on the internet, Cliff, but except the show. that supposedly the word soccer actually did originate in England first. Supposedly.
It should, since it's so bloody popular over there. I mean,
yeah.
So, listen, I don't make the rules. And... I know over there they call American football, or gridiron, they used to call it too.
Yeah.
I don't know if they still do or not, but...
I don't know. They call it the NFL. I think it's American football, because they have all the other leagues there and stuff like that, so...
Yeah.
But we digress. Speaking of football, Canadian football, Alouettes went into this game trying to extend their winning streak. And I thought that it was an interesting comment today that I saw. I think it's out of the Edmonton paper. I think something was picked up in the Edmonton paper today. A funny thing about that, where it was talking about that. It was from Cody Fajardo. And he goes, you know, the streak is nice, but it seems to be the fans and the local media that are talking about it. And I'm thinking, it's fair because it's to hype up everybody, to bring people into the stands and stuff like that. But as you and I have come to learn, Cliff, it's best to just go 1-0 each week. And it just so happens that's what you've done for all that period of time. And that's what happens to be your record that currently.
So, yeah. You know. And I understand where Cody's coming from, because let's not forget, last year we've talked about this a billion times. So we'll probably talk a billion more. The disrespect that was shown to the Alouettes is not there this year. Like, now people have no choice but to acknowledge the Alouettes. And simply put, this is a championship team, and they're playing like a championship team. They're playing like a team that just simply doesn't know how to lose. And you ask any of those guys in the locker room, they're not thinking, they're not believing their own hype. They're not, you know, thinking that they're the greatest thing since sliced bread. Like, they've managed to keep themselves extremely grounded and just say, yeah, it was great that we won, but now we got to go 1-0 next week. And that's the mindset you got to have. You simply got to have. You cannot rest on your laurels. You can't start believing your own press clippings or anything like that. And I don't think Cody Fajardo does that either. I think he's just happy to get the win, but now it's on to the next. Like, it's already forgotten. Like, we win, it's great, on to the next one. And truthfully, that's how it's got to be. You got to win or lose. I think you've got to flush out. Like, what's happened in the past is in the past. You can't go back and look on that. You got to look to the future. You got to look forward. And I think that's exactly what this Alouettes team does. And I think that's the reason why, simply put, in 2024, they have not lost a regular season game to date.
Yeah, I know. And what's funny is that when I was walking in a Percival Molson this week, because as we've known, through this season, that the Alouettes have done a very good job when it came to the next man up, whenever somebody happens to go down, whether it be on defense, offense, or otherwise. Mm-hmm. Well, coming into the stadium after seeing each other quickly over the tailgate, and I had an Alouettes member of the Alouettes staff come up to me, and I guess an Alouettes birdie told me.
a little birdie from the Alouettes.
A little birdie we were going to be having a change at kicker because in pregame warmups, David Cote did something bad enough, as we found out, I think, a couple days later, is that Cote ended up being on the 6-game injured list. So Jose Maltos was going to be taking over. But then we go and find out later, right, Cliff, that not only did Cote go down, but also his long snap partner also went down, didn't he?
Yeah, Louis-Philippe Bourassa also hurt himself somehow, which is, again, not ideal to have anyone. Like, when it comes to field goals, you want to have you got to put your best foot forward, no pun intended. You got to make sure you've got the right people in place. David Cote, by and large, has been that guy for the Alouettes for the past couple of years. Doing absolutely phenomenal work as far as I'm concerned. Not perfect, of course, but I mean, let's face it, unless you're Sean White, basically nobody's perfect this year. But yeah, once again, it's where your depth gets tested. It's next man up. We've seen it numerous times on this team this year already. And you'd think that special teams would be safe, but no, it's not. And you better have a good kicker ready to go. And thankfully, the Montreal Alouettes do have a very good kicker at the ready in Jose Maltos. Again, even if it's like a half hour before kickoff, when you get that call, when your number is called, you got to be ready to go. And sure enough, Jose pretty much had to jump into his uniform and get ready to play a game.
Yeah, it was. I think there was the only practice this week for the Alouettes. They interviewed him, and he was like, it was basically, I need to get ready. that type of thing is, it's a good thing that he brought his pads, right? Even though he was currently on the practice roster. So,
I mean, that credits the Alouettes organization and, having the wherewithal to pack his uniform and his pads and his gear and everything. Just, sorry, tonight you're not watching on the sidelines. You're in there. I mean, that's crazy. I mean, sometimes it happens that quickly, ladies and gentlemen. And once again, you got to be ready. That's why they have practices. That's why they have all these things, because you just never know what's going to happen. I mean, it's such a fluky thing to get hurt during warmups of all things, but.
Well, I think it's funny both our long snapper and our kicker get hurt in warmups.
I'm baffled. When you hear stuff like that, you're just like, what? Can that be? Like, is that really a thing? And well, this past Saturday, it 100% absolutely was a thing.
Yeah, it was that thing. But as I said, we've had him, since he's been on the team, he's whenever he's had the chance, he's been fine. So I don't think Alouettes fans or the Alouettes fans that knew, I don't think really had an issue, because we knew he was a good kicker. People just need to go back to last year when Cote was off for two, because he was, as you put it, last year he was getting the yips, and something was off in his kicking.
Yeah, and turned out he was injured there as well. So I mean, sometimes it's like that. And rather than put yourself in harm's way, you step aside and let someone else, let the understudy come in and perform. And that's exactly what Jose Maltos does. Like, when he comes into a game, he comes in ready to go and does phenomenal. I mean, I still think back to the last year, that first preseason game in Ottawa. He was the kicker for that game and ended up kicking the game-winning field goal. And yes, I know preseason doesn't count in the standings or any of that nonsense, but if you're talking about player evaluation, well, you take a look at the film on Jose Maltos there, and it's like, wow, okay. God forbid something happens to David Cote, at least we've got, an ace up our sleeve. And that's exactly what Jose Maltos has been as a member of the Montreal Alouettes, is he's been the go-to guy. Like, if in an emergency situation, you tap him on the shoulder, he's ready to go.
Yep. And as Danny Mac did, Danny Mac does, You signed somebody else. We'll talk about that in a little bit. And we did sign another name quarterback. But again, we'll talk about that when we talk about the transactions and stuff like that. But, you know, going forward, again, we were missing some people going into this game. You know, Sean Lemon, which we're going to talk about also, which we happened to miss last week because it was announced after the show had already been done.
You're right.
But we'll talk about that. But the Alouettes went into this game where, you know, again, it's another home game for the Alouettes. Home cooking, that type of stuff. And, you know, this Alouettes team, even though they really did not play their best game, I would probably say, well, their first half, but it really wasn't their best half of the year. They still were able to come away with a win over the Stamps. You know, I mean, it's, you know, and the way they did it too, I mean, knocking off Calgary 30-26, but, you know, as we've seen many a time this year, Cliff, whether it be complete blowouts or whether it be a close score, you know, the score, the end score itself really was not indicative of what type of game this was.
No. And simply put, winners find a way to win. And that's exactly how you would describe this Montreal Alouettes team. They're winners and they found a way to win. It was not pretty. Absolutely. I even said, you know, at halftime, like that second quarter was arguably the worst football I've seen this team play in 2024. And at that point you say, okay, well, that was bad. That was not good. I mean, that was just as bad as you'd ever hope to see. I mean, just not great, but can you recover from this? And then I think that's the key, is you're now facing some adversity, which some teams don't know how to handle adversity. Montreal, though, finds a way to handle the adversity. Okay, at one point they were down 23-9. Not great, but beautiful thing about the Canadian Football League is, and it's cliched as hell to say, but no lead truly is safe. I mean, there's always a chance. As long as your team's in it, there's always a chance. And the adjustments made in the second half made a huge difference. Like, it was almost like they just woke up and realized, oh crap, we're the Montreal Alouettes, the reigning, defending, undisputed Grey Cup champions. We can't be losing to this Calgary team that is 2-1 at the time, but I mean, we shouldn't be losing to a team like this. And they got their act together, they figured it out, and yeah, it was a gutsy comeback, and they simply put, found a way to win.
Yeah, they did. And as you know, it really is. I totally agree with you, Cliff. It is a tale of two halves. I mean, Alouettes were outscored in the first half 23-12, but they only held Calgary to 3 points in the second half, including a scoreless fourth quarter. So they did something. But again, we have to go back and we got to talk about the second quarter because, you know, despite how the Owls scored in the first, really the second quarter was, in my opinion, it was the focal point of the game itself because it set the stage for the second half. It wasn't the halftime show that the Alouettes had. It's the second quarter that set the stage for the second half. And it was the weirdest thing. I mean, I think it was like anything could happen to the Alouettes. Cliff really did, whether it be, you know, injuries, whether it be interceptions, whether it be turnovers. That's exactly what happened. And what's funny about this too, Cliff, is that this is still they come into the second quarter and this is a Cody Fajardo, as we've seen how well he's done. And he's most games this year, he started off on streaks of X amount in a row before something happens, you know, an interception or incompletion or something like that.
Right.
You know, for the second game in a row, Cody starts off at least 10 for 10. Mm-hmm. So last week was 12 for 12. This week is 10 for 10. And his first one this week was a first incompletion was an interception. But the funny thing was, though, prior to that, though, it all started with something that we don't see all that often is we happen to see a catch and fumble by our superstar Canadian, Tyson Philpott.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, guess what, folks? They're human. They make mistakes. And it's not something that we're very accustomed to seeing in 2024. Like, I mean, the rapport and the chemistry that Cody Fajardo and Tyson Philpott have is, I'll put it up there with Anthony Calvillo and Ben Cahoon back in the day. I mean, when you think about it, quarterbacks with Latin-sounding last names, Canadian receivers that are tough as nails, making outstanding catches. I mean, there's probably a lot of comparisons you can make. I mean, ACBC, the fact that 7 plus 6 equals 13. I don't know if you can come up with something clever to call them based off of that, but I mean, like, these two, Fajardo and Philpott, I mean, they are magic on this CFL football field. But that second quarter, yeah, it almost felt like they were brought down to earth just a little bit. And you start to wonder, wow, okay, this is uncharted territory a little bit. Like, we're not used to seeing this. And Calgary, to their credit, they played Montreal Alouettes football.
Yeah.
Lots of strikes, lots, you know, keeping second guessing on a lot of things, like showing them different looks. And backup quarterback comes in and does outstanding stuff on third and short.
Does his best example of Chris Trevler.
Pretty much. Or even Caleb Evans with the, mm-hmm. There's that third and two. Tommy Stevens looked like he was going to dive forward to try to get the first down, but no, steps back and not quite a fadeaway jumper shot like what Caleb can throw, but yeah, he rolled out to the side and found, I forget who it was he found, but was able to move the chains like a good 30 yards. Like, just what? Like, that was that's a play right out of the Alouettes book, except for normally that would go for a touchdown, but I digress. Again, Calgary was playing Montreal Alouettes football, and I don't think the Montreal Alouettes themselves knew how to handle it. It's like, oh, is this what we've been doing to everybody this year? Dang. Like, it didn't compute, it felt like. And yeah, I mean, arguably the worst worst quarter of football the Alouettes played this year. And I'm sure actually, we did ask Coach Jason Moss, like, at halftime, what do you tell these guys? Like, do you tear a strip off them? Do you, you know, beat them upside the head for this, you know, kind of play? Or do you just tell them, like, listen, you guys got this. Just do your job. Don't worry about it. You're going to get this figured out. And it was the latter, he ended up telling us. So sometimes that's all it is. It's just, you know what you got to do. Go out and do it. And that's exactly what the Montrealites did in that second half.
Yeah. And for the Alouettes to go at two straight drives with a turnover. You know, it was the Tyson turnover that ended up in points. And obviously then there's the interception by Cody, which was, again, as I said before, his first incompletion or what a way to go for his first well, it wasn't an incompletion. It was technically, you know what I mean.
It went to the wrong. You're going to F up royally.
Yeah. It went to the other player. You know, and then again, it turned into points for Calgary. And as you said, they couldn't stop the run. They couldn't, the turnovers, they couldn't score. You know, one thing, and I was wondering what it was at halftime, because, you know, the full stats weren't available to us at the time, Cliff. But I went and double checked, and it kind of makes sense, you know, after seeing how piss poor that they played. In the second quarter alone, Cliff, the Alouettes held the ball for a grand total of 3 minutes and 58 seconds.
Not ideal. Not ideal. I mean, you want to keep the ball out of your opponent's hands as much as possible. And again, we talked about how incredible this defense is. I mean, they looked average. I mean, it was almost like they were seeing something completely different compared to what they've seen against teams like Winnipeg, Edmonton, Toronto. I mean, it was just like, wait, what? Like, what's going on? But again, it's all about the second half adjustments, which Montreal seemed to be doing extremely well. I mean, in this case, though, they're coming from behind as opposed to trying to maintain the lead they have. Which, again, we talked about the lack of adversity sometimes is what does in some of these really successful teams. I think Montreal got served a bit of humble pie. And I think it made them refocus. It made them snap out of whatever they were going through during that first half. And they went and they played absolutely phenomenal football. Like, there was just no quit. They kept chipping away at the lead. They kept Calgary in check for the most part. And they did what they had to do, simply put.
Yeah. And this is going up against a Jake Maier, you know, Calgary St. Peter's quarterback, who was not playing very well at all himself, and yet Yeah, and the Alouettes only had 9 points on the board. But the funny thing was, though, you know, usually you think going in at halftime and getting, you know, the whole rah-rah bit and making the changes there and some getting some sort of motivation. It seems really strange to me that one of the few things that actually, I think, started the whole rally and the whole motivation thing for the Alouettes was at the end of the second quarter, but it wasn't on a scoring play by the offense. It was actually a scoring play by the special teams.
Oh, yeah. After Jake Maier threw for a touchdown, I think it was against, he threw it to Reggie Bagleton, if I'm not mistaken, which, as I've said, this guy is just in another universe all by himself as far as receivers go in this league. But lining up for the extra point attempt, big Mustafa Johnson just put his big meaty paw up there and just pow, smacked the football right down, like practically planted the football into the ground, bounced into the waiting arms of who else but Kabian Ento, and he takes it to the house. Where have we seen this before? Oh, yeah, last year. Who's it against? Oh, yeah, Calgary at home. This is the second time now that Kabian Ento has taken one to the house. I mean, technically not a touchdown per se, but to basically take a Calgary ball and return it for points, this would be the second time in as many years that Kabian Ento has done that. And you absolutely love to see it.
Yeah, and with his family in the stands too. His whole family was there. If anybody happened to watch the post-game show from Joe Alfieri, his whole family was there. So yeah, what a great game for him to do that. And as I said, just those 2 points alone, Cliff. That and then the field goal at the end of the half, which I know you and I questioned, but hindsight now, you know, it started the Alouettes to roll. And the plus was that not only did they kick the field goal at the end of the half, they're able to double dip and they got the kickoff at the beginning of the second half. And from there, it just went from there.
Yeah, and I think also, too, another motivating factor, too, was the their defensive superstar, Marc-Antoine Ducroix, he exited the game with a shoulder injury. So once again, next man up. You got your superstar going out of the game and not coming back. That had to help motivate this team as well, because you want to win for him. You want to win for Ducroix, of course. Mm-hmm. Because normally he'd be out there leading the charge. I mean, like, he actually had a couple of really nice defensive plays in that first half that helped keep helped keep Montreal close to Calgary. But yeah, losing the quad injury for the night was not great. I mean, not ideal at all. But once again, next man up. I believe, if I'm not mistaken, it was Najee Murray who's slotted over into the safety spot.
Yep.
And you keep rolling. Simply put, that's what the Alouettes team does, is just keeps on rolling. And listen, they made up for his absence in a big way. This defense really did come together. As we talked about, the second half, all Calgary could manage was a field goal. And all the way to the very end, when Calgary was trying, like, once Montreal had taken the lead and Calgary was trying to get back to at least possibly score. I think they would have had, they're down by four. They would have had to score a touchdown. And the hopes and dreams of Jake Maier and the Calgary Stampeders got snuffed out by one Deontay Ruffin with an absolutely beautiful, beautiful pick to seal this game.
It was kind of a bait and gotcha type of thing. By the way, we're talking about next man up. I had also read too not only was it Najee who took over for Ducroix, but we also had guys who were basically rotating in and out trying to make sure that, you know, everything was cool. You know, as the next man up, it was Titus Wall, and it was also our guy, I guess we can say now, you know, who stepped in the place for Stubblefield is Bryce Cosby. So we had three guys basically rotating enough and knowing the positions well enough that it was able to keep the Alouettes defense pretty square for the rest of the night.
Yeah. And Najee already had some pretty outstanding pass breakups throughout the game as well. So, I mean, this is a guy that knows the secondary up and down. And if wherever you need him to be, that's where he's going to be. And he just proving once again, like, you know, he was felled by injuries last year, but this is kind of a comeback season for him. Like, this is a redemption for him. So watching him go out there and play like his hair is on fire, that's what you want to see. And, okay, he's got to step in for, you know, the great Canadian superstar, DeCroix. No problem. He can do that. You need him on. You need him in the center at safety. He's got it. You need him out on out in his defensive back. He can do that too. If you have to switch him to corner, you can do that as well. You name it, he can do it. He's kind of like a Swiss Army knife, if you will, for the secondary. And when you got guys like DeCroix going down to injury, you need someone that can step into just about any role that's necessary. And Najee Murray has been doing that for years now. And you're seeing it again in 2024. Like, he is definitely coming to play, just like the rest of this defense.
Yeah. And, you know, props to the O-line again. They held Cody did not have to worry about cleaning his jersey this week because he was upright the entire game. Neither team got a sack, though, but still. You know, and I think it's overall across the league, though, Cliff, that sacks are down in the CFL in 2024. But still, to go from what they were last year at this time to what they are now is outstanding, obviously.
Yeah. But what I find interesting, though, is especially Calgary in that third quarter, Montreal's driving down the field. And there's a couple of times where Cody just wasn't connecting. It wasn't working, but saved by a penalty because Calgary just made an error, like illegal contact on a receiver, or I think there was another pass interference call that was made as well. I mean, just things like that slowly moved the chains forward and let this Alouettes team start the comeback to eventually beat the Stampeders. I mean, it comes down to discipline more than anything else. I mean, that's one thing Noel Thorpe has preached with this defense, and I would say the entire Alouettes team, by and large, has prided themselves on is their discipline. They really don't take too many stupid penalties, if any at all. I mean, not perfect. Yeah, they will take one or two occasional penalties, but they don't act the fool out there, as they say. Like, they don't do anything stupid that's going to get themselves in trouble and cost them yardage as a result.
Yeah, pokes again. And one of the things too, you know, I think we talked about it on Flight Deck Live. And by the way, if you haven't missed that, head over to our YouTube page. You can watch this past episode where we had a surprise guest again. Who, when you're live, as Cliff would say, anything can happen. And that's what happened. So make sure you head over to YouTube and check out the latest episode from this past week. Yep. How, because we talked to Walter Fletcher post game, and we were like, we felt that they were getting away from the run, even though this game was close-ish, even into the third quarter. You know, it basically what Walter did the entire first half was that one 19-yard run, and that was it.
Yeah.
But all in all, at the end of the day, as Montreal Alouette running backs can do, they're great out of the backfield when it comes to catching passes and doing what they need to do. Because, you know, Fletcher was a huge part of that second half. You know, I mean, Tyson did well. Obviously, all of our other receivers did well, and we'll get to that here in a couple of minutes. But what are your initial thoughts on this, Cliff? Because, again, Cody pulled off another Cody run for 11 yards. What's your thought when it comes to how they ended up using them the way they should? Because, as we saw, Fletch scored the go-ahead and game-winning touchdown. What are your thoughts? It's just a matter of what Calgary is giving them. Yeah, because it was like, you know, Fletch did seem like an afterthought after the first half.
Initially, yes. But once again, obviously adjustments had to be made in the second half, and that's exactly what happened. It's funny, even Fletch, when we were talking to him, he called himself Captain Checkdown, because that's pretty much what he was for Cody, was his checkdown option. And it works. You know what? It totally worked. And in fact, I still think about that one-handed stab that Fletch made to move the chains. Like, just kept basically turned against his own body one-handed, caught the ball, and went for a run. I mean, wow. I mean, we've come to expect that out of Walter Fletcher. I mean, he had that outstanding game in Edmonton a couple of weeks ago. He just he's just one of those guys, you call upon him, he will do great things. And that's exactly what happened because, yeah, the receivers, you know, they were doing a very good job, very respectable for the most part. But, I mean, sometimes those guys get, like, double, maybe even triple coverage. I mean, I think eventually they knew they had to keep their as many people on Tyson Philpott as possible. In which case, yeah, you go to your check down. You go to your running back who can turn on the jets and get those extra yards or just even grind it out with his legs. I mean, that's what's great about Walter Fletcher is he is that kind of running back that he can present sort of a dual threat, not just running the ball, but catching as well. And I give him all the credit for he was a big part of that comeback was just his ability to play both sides, both receiving and rushing.
Yeah.
And yeah, that touchdown that he scored, the ultimately the game winning touchdown was an absolute thing of beauty. And he just deked out, I think it was Trey Roberson, like just basically broke his ankles on that play.
That one last move at the end. I will admit. Yeah. Yeah. But he also had the angle because he easily could have gone out of bounds. I think, didn't we talk to him in the, I think he said it post game. Not to ask, but it was during one of the post game interviews. I think he was saying that it was originally supposed to be a go down at the two type of thing. I think that was what the play was called.
Right.
But yet, why? There's so much time left. You might as well go ahead and take it into the end zone. And I'm sure we're all glad that he did.
Yeah. And that's the thing, too. I mean, I get the strategy of it trying to burn as much clock as possible and then score. But at the same time, you got the momentum, and that's clearly what it was with Walter, is he clearly had the momentum. Like, he just was not going to go down. And at that point, I think this defense realized, okay, we take the lead. We cannot, like, you know bloody well, you've got to score. They should have been up by five at least, up by six to force a touchdown. But
go ahead and expound on that, because we were talking about what happened earlier with the Owls block. That easily could have turned this game.
Yeah, you live by the block, you die by the block. And the Alouettes tried to go for two. I believe it was another batted ball that was recovered by Calgary. I forget who it was that recovered it.
It was a pick.
It was.
On the two-point convert, it was a pick.
Yes, sorry, my bad.
It's okay.
It was. You're absolutely right. It was a pick. And damn near took that to the house, too. And if that would have happened, that... Once again, all that momentum, everything good that was building up for Montreal, I wouldn't say it wouldn't have been snuffed, but it definitely puts you in a tough position. Just like what KB Nento's 2-point intercept or recovery and score, just kind of like how that helped kind of turn the tide just a little bit more to the Alouettes' favor. Could that have been the same thing for Calgary? We'll never know for sure, but I mean, it's just one of those things you absolutely want to avoid. And thankfully, the Alouettes were able to prevent that Calgary defender from scoring. And ultimately, at that point now, the Alouettes led by four. You had no choice but to go for a touchdown if you're the Stampeders. And once again, the crowd got called upon to be as loud as possible.
No kidding.
The energy that you could feel throughout the stadium. And let's not forget, folks, we had over 20,000 people in the stands. A lot of people thought, okay, are you going to be able to top the sellout that you had for the first game against Ottawa? Probably not, just because it's summertime, Saturday night, you just never know, right? Especially in Montreal, which is like Party City Central. But the fact that they had over 20,000 fans at the game Saturday night, the electricity, the noise, everything that came at that moment, it was just, I always say, welcome to the Thunderdome, because that's exactly what it is. The noise level is deafening. When this crowd gets hyped, when everybody gets excited, and players tell us all the time too, they hear everything. They hear the noise, and it's almost very distracting, even for those on defense, but they love every second of it. That means you're engaged. That means you're into it, Alouettes fans. I mean, that's why you make noise on defense. That's why you get loud in an instance like that. And look what happened. Look what happened to Calgary when they tried to make the comeback and ultimately it fell short.
Yeah. Back-to-back 20,000 plus crowds, Cliff, for the first time since the end of the 2016 season. I'm hoping on Thursday it'll be tough, but I hope they can make it three in a row on Thursday. We'll see.
That'd be amazing. Tell you the truth. I mean, Thursday night football, I mean, like it or not, it's here to stay. And as much as you and I and other Alouettes supporters complain about having these Thursday night games. So apparently there's a market for them. And I'm sorry, I don't see it, but it's one of those things where it's got to happen. And if it was one of those instances where every single team had to host a Thursday night football game, and including Montreal, then so be it. But once again, this year we're saddled with three, if I'm not mistaken, three Thursday night games at home. And it's such a tough sell. Like, downtown is not packed with people like it used to be. And you hope for that walk-up crowd at the last second. It's not there. I'm sorry to say it's not there. Between the construction and the hot weather and even, like, you know, this hurricane-like weather that we were supposed to be, like, the after effects of the hurricane barrel possibly leading to beaucoup rain tomorrow for the game, or later today for the game, depending on when you're listening to this. I'll be stunned. I'd be thrilled if the Alouettes are able to draw another 20,000 in on a Thursday night. But I'm not liking it. I'm not liking the odds of that happening, to tell you the God's honest truth.
Yeah. For the Alouettes, Cody Fajardo went 35 of 42, Cliff, for 374 yards, two touchdowns, two interceptions, and one interception in the second quarter, and then that one interception, which again, as I mentioned on Flight Deck Live, was during the 2-point convert. I really still don't think that those should count, but anyways, I will leave it at that. Leading rusher for the team was Walter Fletcher. He had five attempts for 56 yards. Longest one's that 31-yard touchdown to seal the game. Cody Fajardo had 35 yards also in the game. And we mentioned that before, that 11-yard rush by Cody. Won a game, right? For the Alouettes, leading receiver, Tyson Philpott. Listen to these stats, folks. 13 targets. 12 receptions, 134, and no touchdowns, but still, he was a target machine during the game this week. KJG, happy birthday, KJG. Had his first CFL touchdown this year in 2024. He was four receptions for 20 yards. Charleston Rambo, four receptions for 40. He actually did quite well too, actually, in some of his routes.
Very solid. Yep.
Yeah. Cole Speaker, who just absolutely mashed in the end zone on his 17-yard touchdown.
God, he took a lick.
Yeah, but still, four receptions, 48 yards. Reggie White, two receptions for 28. And we can't forget about Walter Fletcher. Perfect on the night, Cliff. 9 for 9, 9 targets, 9 receptions, 104 yards. And 100 yak yards.
It's not yak yards.
Sorry. You're right. Because yard, Y in yak is yards.
It's not yards after catch yards. It's just yak. Sorry. Yeah. It's a pet peeve. But yeah.
Canadian football stats 101.
Yeah.
Yards after, how about this? 100 yards after catch. Are you happy now?
Better.
Okay. Better.
And listen, we got nothing but love for Walter Fletcher. Anyone who listens to this podcast knows how highly we think of him, how, you know, we want the best for him. And it does our heart good to see him play at such a phenomenal level. I mean, and proof that he can do it all. I mean, you need him to run the ball, he can do that. You need him to catch the ball, he can do that. You need him to block, he's good at that too. I mean, he's, as I said, like a Swiss Army knife. He does a little bit of everything. And my goodness, it just couldn't come at a better time.
Yeah, no, I agree. Yeah. And I was looking at one of the stats you're trying to find here. Was put up by David Arsenault of RDS. 160 total yards, 104 yards, as I said, receiving. First time, what is it? First time since William Stanback back in 2018. Where you have a guy with a running back with over 100 yards of receiving.
That's incredible. And I mean, that was a big thing too this year, was with the departure of William Stanback. Could Walter Fletcher step into that role that Stanback did? Because those are some pretty big shoes to fill. And
yeah,
it's pretty obvious now that yes, Walter Fletcher is able to do that, and then some. I mean, he has really truly been an outstanding force for the Alouettes in the backfield.
Yeah, I've got, I say we talked about it before. You got to talk about Jose Montos, 3 for 3, perfect on the night. You know, in relief of David Cote, and I said he is our guy going forward. So, quickly, let's talk about, as I said, we talk about Daquan, and we see that he is currently a game time decision. You and I have talked about this once we saw the depth charts today. Being with the changes that the Alouettes have made, even if Daquan doesn't play, and considering what they did last week, I think the Alouettes are in a pretty good situation, though, aren't they?
They are. And listen, if Daquan's good and he's ready to go, and it was funny, even Coach Moss had kind of gave like a little wink and a nod saying that he'll be okay. He'll be fine. Like, I definitely see the Alouettes erring on the side of caution and just saying to Daquan, listen, we got the bye next week. Not saying that Toronto is a gimme by any stretch of the imagination, because they're not. But at the same time, we don't want to do anything to jeopardize you for the long term. Like, personally, I'd say to Daquan, you know what? Just trying to keep them guessing as best we can. But yeah, you're not playing tonight. Like, you take the time properly to rest and make sure you're back in time for the game on the 25th against Saskatchewan.
Yeah. The Alouettes, by the way, did hold Jake Maier to a very paltry 18 of 28. He just did, oh, you know, that's okay. But he only had 106 yards. So, you know, touchdown, interception, I'll leave it at that. But the defense just played really, really, really well. And as I said, even with Daquan out, they were able to step up. And I think we real quickly, we touched, you know, we spoke with, or at least, yeah, we saw, you know, the coach at the end of the game asked him about the defense, and he was pretty happy with it. So I can't complain. I can't complain at all. So
no, a lot of guys stepping up where they had to. Like, just guys go down to injury all the time. That's unfortunately that's what seems to be for the Alouettes this year, is like that 6-game list is getting deeper and deeper by the day as the day goes by. But guys are stepping up. Guys are showing up and showing out. I mean, you look at what this defensive line is able to do. I mean, they've just been terrorizing quarterbacks. Like, that basically helped keep Jake Maier to such mid numbers. I mean, like, no wonder if Calgary was going to win this game, it was basically because of their backup quarterbacks more so than what Jake Maier was able to do. I mean, he was just not that good, to tell you the truth. I mean, there's any number of reasons why Calgary had lost this game. But I mean, I had a hard time believing in Jake Maier. And yes, he did win 2 games this year, but again, they were against a not very good Hamilton team, and beating Winnipeg in overtime, just barely beating them in overtime. I mean, mm-hmm. there was nothing outstanding about his play. Like, I just found he's serviceable at best. I mean, yeah. I think that's how I see Jake Maier. I was very surprised not to see Matthew Schiltz take any reps as well.
Same.
Like you, if you didn't know better, you'd swear you didn't even know he was on the team. I mean, like, okay, yeah, Tommy Stevens was doing some pretty good stuff out there too in short yardage, and as I said, a couple of plays to extend the drives, but like, if Jake Maier wasn't cutting it, like, you'd think he would have given Schiltz a couple of looks, because we know what he can do. And I'm truly surprised, to tell you the truth, that Schiltz isn't the starting quarterback in Calgary versus Maier, because yeah, Maier's been okay. And yes, they are 2-2 on the season. But realistically, I really haven't seen very much out of Jake Maier that says, yeah, he's the guy. He's got to be the guy.
Yeah, exactly. A lot more to talk about, but I'll remind everybody first that we are on social media, many places you can find us. You can find us over on X at Alouettes FL Deck. You can follow us over at Facebook at Alouettes Flight Deck Pod, and at Instagram, and on, I'm just watching your fingers. anybody who's watching the video version, you know what I'm talking about here.
People know where that is, right?
Yeah, Instagram and YouTube over at Alouettes Flight Deck. YouTube, you can find the audio version. You can find the video version of the podcast, and also you can find our post-game companion show in Flight Deck Live, where, as we've said, almost anything can happen when you're live. So make sure you go back and check the past couple of episodes. But and do we do expect to be alive again this week following the game on Thursday versus the Toronto Argonauts. So stay tuned to all of our socials. If you're looking to listen to any of the past episodes, heading all the way back to the very beginning, head over to our archive and our main homepage over at www.alouettesflightdeck.ca. And if you want to rep the merch, whether it be from one of our logo shirts to maybe the Cartoon Bird 56 t-shirt, you can head over to www.flightdeckgear.ca. And real quickly, speaking of merch, and I know we put it on social media today, Cliff, but we are able to get basically our prototype of what our Cartoon Bird head 56 cap would look like. It came out absolutely amazing. Props, obviously, and want to thank. I finally found somebody who was able to do it, and you know, thanks to Custom Leeds Customs who were able to do it. Anybody who is interested, stay tuned to our socials. We have an idea. If you want one, stay tuned to the socials, and we'll try to make sure that we offer to them, because just like the shirts, Cliff, it seems to me that the caps are a pretty hot topic right now. So I'm glad we came up with the idea. So
definitely. And folks, once again, I have to remind you, if you are watching or listening on YouTube, make sure you subscribe to the channel, make sure you hit the like button, leave us a comment, let us know what we're doing right, what we're doing wrong. And hit that notification bell as well, so that you'll know when we go live with Flight Deck Live or when the newest episode drops. You'll be notified right away. And if you're following on X, that's great, because that way you too will also get notified when we go live and when we put new stuff up and everything like that. So make sure you're subscribed to all of our channels. Make sure, however it is that you're consuming the podcast, make sure you're a subscriber. Make sure you're following us. Make sure you're doing all those things. And be part of the flight crew.
Exactly. So we talked about the defense, and this is one thing that I wanted to at least touch on, because it was something that came out after the show had gone out to the masses last week, is the whole Sean Lemon situation. Mm-hmm. Everybody knows that what had happened earlier in the year, you know, about him being caught betting on the teams that he was playing for. It's all amounts to, I think they said it was what, 70 euros, if I'm not mistaken, or something like that.
Something along those lines.
Yeah. And it was back in one of the most recent one was back when he was playing for the Calgary Stampeders. Mm-hmm. He, as you may remember, he basically contested his suspension. And the date came up to where they were going to try to set a date for where they are when his appeal was going to be. And the CFL asked for him to be suspended, and the judge agreed. So now, first and foremost, Cliff, what was your pool number on how many games we had Lemon before he left, before he was suspended? I was wrong. I was close. I think I said five. I have to go back and check. I think I said five.
I want to say either four or five. We had said. Because also, too, the original date was July 5th, was supposed to be his hearing with the Canadian Football League. And he asked for an adjournment until August for whatever reason. And for the league reasons, said, yeah, whatever the case may be. I mean, also, let's not forget, too, he's actually not going through the CFLPA. He's actually choosing to represent himself, which, as we joked about, literally betting on himself, which, I mean, you got to admire the spirit of that. So, after asking for the adjournment, the Canadian Football League moved for him to be suspended until they can have that hearing, which apparently will be in August. And now the Alouettes, once again, have to shuffle things around. I mean, thankfully, Danny Machocha is constantly working on this defensive line, always trying to find ways to improve upon it and make the best even better. And simply put, now you've got to start planning without Sean Lemon for the short term and possibly the long term as well, depending on what the judge decides. Because they could say, no, you're finished. You're done. You're never playing a game in this league again, which would be incredibly disappointing. But, I mean, that is a possibility, something to think about. Or maybe the games that he's going to be missing now, maybe that will be factored into his... whatever they decide to suspend, however many games decide to suspend him for, hopefully the games that he's missed to date, which right now is one, actually it'll be two as of Thursday. Mm-hmm. Hopefully that'll be taken into consideration as well. Once again, this is something that's really never happened before. So there's not, it's not like there's a precedent to sort of go by as to what to do when a player bets on games that he's an active member in. This is uncharted territory. I guess that would be the best way to describe it.
It is, but it's also a hot, as you and I have talked about before, it's also a hot button topic in the CFL, considering what happened in Toronto earlier this season from their starting quarterback. So everybody seems to be playing judge and jury and trying to weigh it properly on, does this, what was done in Toronto by the Toronto quarterback, does that equate more a suspension than, you know, than Lemon does? It's, see,
you're comparing apples to fire trucks. I mean, it's like,
I know, completely... but that's how people are, you know this, but that's how people are looking at it.
I get it, especially too, like, and as Montreal supporters, obviously we want the best for Sean Lemon. Like we've had him on the show. We know what a good guy he is. I mean, league wide too. I mean, I think all he has to do is go and sign with the Hamilton Tiger Cats and he will have completed the Kevin Glenn tour of this league. Whereas Chad Kelly, I mean, he's absolutely loved by a lot of Toronto fans, but definitely not so much loved now by a lot of other fans of this league. And again, don't blame them at all either. I mean, we're talking about two completely different scenarios and trying to conflate the two, as far as I'm concerned, is a fool's errand. And you really can't. I mean, does Lemon deserve to be punished? Possibly. I mean, it's such a silly thing. I get letter of the law and all that jazz. So don't come after me for that. But I guess if you have to mete out some sort of punishment for Lemon, it can't be on par with, you know, you can't do it based on what happened to Chad Kelly. It's two completely different scenarios. I mean, to even try and compare the two is preposterous as far as I'm concerned. So I sincerely hope that whatever happens, if they do, you know, decide to give him a lengthy enough suspension, but not one that would end his career in the Canadian Football League, I hope that the games that he's missed to date, as I said, last week and this week to start with, I hope that's taken into consideration as well. I mean, if you got to suspend him to send a message, quote unquote, fine, so be it. I mean, I understand why you want to get away from that, even though the fact that the Canadian Football League is practically in bed with all sorts of betting companies as well. So the idea that they're going to suspend a player for betting while taking in sponsorship money from all these, online gambling sites and such, seems a little sus, as they say.
Hypocritical.
That too. I mean, you can't have your cake and eat it too. You know what I mean? So
no,
we'll see what happens in August when Sean Lemon has his hearing with the league. And I don't know. I mean, if you gotta suspend him. But I sincerely hope that this is not how his career ends in the Canadian Football League.
You know, it's very possible with the way that the things are going, with the way the schedule is, it is very possible his decision may come about at the same time that Chad Kelly is eligible to come back. Wouldn't that be interesting?
It would. I mean, let's not forget too, Chad Kelly's suspension. Right now it's 9 games, but he's got to prove that he's rehabilitating himself. He's got to prove that he's learned from his mistakes and he's growing and all that stuff. And if you looked at some of his tweets lately, like, he's still very erratic, like almost like he doesn't understand why he's been suspended. Like it's like that too is not looking, it's not a great look for him either. So, I mean, will he just be suspended 9 games? Could it be possibly more? Like, will he be able to prove that he's learned his lesson from everything that went down? I guess only time's going to tell, but
yeah,
it would be unfortunate to see Sean Lemon's career ended this way. I mean, in a way, it would also be unfortunate for Chad Kelly because, I mean, he when he was playing well, I mean, yeah, everybody loved him, but I mean, unfortunately, your past, sometimes you try as you can to escape it. Sometimes it just keeps roaring back to you.
Yeah. By the way, real quick before we move on, we also have to give props. Obviously, you're talking about how you know, Coach Thorpe, Danny, and Danny Matrocha have been able to make sure that they have enough guys to back them up. We got to give props to the guy who took over for Sean Lemon also.
Oh my God. Yeah. Just, I mean, let's face it. As I said, this entire defensive line has been gangbusters, but, you know, go down the list, Isaac Berglund, Derek Wigan, Mustafa Johnson. My God. To see what this line has been able to do, and especially in the absence of a Sean Lemon, absolutely tremendous. Avery Ellis has come in and just looked phenomenal. Like, he has really come alive. And I don't know, like, we saw what he was able to do when he was a member of the Ottawa Red Blacks, played some outstanding football there, comes to Montreal, almost, I don't want to say reinvents himself per se, but he, at least he doesn't look out of place here. I guess that would be the best way to put it. And more often than not, he's subbing in for a lot of those guys, including Sean Lemon.
Yeah.
But he's had no choice. He's had to step up. He's had to come and be playing on the line with the other big boys. And he's done a fantastic job. I mean, it's just really outstanding. Like, I mean, once again, credit to everybody on this coaching staff and for Danny Mac to be able to find players like this. And it's when you're not worried. Like, yeah, it sucks that Sean Lemon got suspended. And, you know, he definitely was an integral part of that championship team in 2023 and was doing some really good stuff in 2024 as well. But, you know, whether it was because of his gambling suspension or if, God forbid, he got injured and had to be replaced, simply put, plug and play, next man up, whatever you want to call it, this party just keeps rolling. And that's a credit to everybody in this organization for just getting it, for understanding what needed to be done, understanding the assignment, as they say, and just making it happen. And you got to give major, major props to this defensive line. They just keep doing the thing over and over again. And next person that joins this, they will be outstanding too. And we'll talk about that in the game preview, because there is a young man that we talked about earlier this year that was drafted by the Alouettes, who's going to be making his debut in the starting lineup. Ooh, I'm excited to see this kid play.
Yeah, and by the way, the guy that we're talking about who was able to step up last week was Jordan Dominic. Just want to give props to him because he was the one who was able to step in. So, speaking of next man up, it seems to be the last couple of years, Cliff, that some years we're able to take advantage of who we have on the roster and who we don't. But heading into this week's game, we got 12 guys. We now have 12 guys on the six-game injured list.
Oh, it's ridiculous. Like, I mean, you almost have an all-star team of talent on this list. I mean, guys like Reggie Stubblefield, Wesley Sutton, Brock Gowenlock is back on the six-game list. Tyrell Richards, Jamar McGlosser. Like, these are guys that Tyler Snead. these guys have Grey Cup rings because they were part of that championship team last year. Major contributors to that as well, I may add. Like, this would break a lot of teams. And it's not ideal. Don't get me wrong. I'm not thinking, oh, well, we don't need those guys because we're just so talented and so full of depth. No, it's not about that. It's just the simple fact that, okay, this sucks, but who's going to step up now? And we've talked about what kind of depth this team has. Starting at the draft, being able to draft guys that can eventually come in and replace a lot of these older players that may go down to injury or end up retiring. But in a case like this, it's not so much the older players that are getting hurt, it's the superstars that are getting hurt. And okay, now it's time for the understudy to come in and see what they can do. And I'm excited in the sense that I want to see what these guys can do, because we've been hyping them up. We've been talking about how impressed we were watching them at training camp. Well, now the lights are bright. Now this is your chance to show that you belong on this team. You got to give them a reason not to have you on this in the starting lineup. We talked about it last year with Reggie Stubblefield, how he was cut, brought back because a lot of guys got banged up. He got his opportunity. He made the most of it. And look what happened to him. Is there somebody on this practice roster that can have that sort of same impact for the Alouettes in 2024? We're about to find out, because once again, we're in that same situation that we were last year, where guys were banged up. Guys were on the six-game list or done for the season. Okay, who's going to replace them? And that's where like the KB Dentos come in. That's where the Reggie Stubblefields come in. And they weren't perfect. They had to take their lumps. They had some not great games, but they got it figured out. And they were major contributors to what ended up being a Grey Cup winning championship team. Now the time has come for these guys to come in and show that they can do that as well. Or at the very least, not let things slide down. I think that's going to be key. I you want to put too big of an expectation on a lot of these rookie players, but it's like you're basically throwing them in the deep end and find out if they're going to sink or swim. And I think a lot of these guys, when it's all said and done, we got some swimmers here. So let's let them swim.
Yep, exactly. Real quickly too, by the way, speaking of, the Owls are doing well. So is RDS. The game this week, Cliff on RDS, the Owls game versus Calgary, averaged 331,000 people just on the French broadcast alone. According to numerous data, that's the largest number since November 1st, 2015. English and French for the week, Cliff, well above being the highest game of the week. TSN and RDS together, more than 670,000 people watched this game last Saturday night.
And I guarantee they were all entertained. Well, maybe not the folks that were watching out of Calgary, but people are loving the Alouettes. They love a championship team. They love a team that is fun to watch. And that's what this Alouettes team has become in 2024, is just fun to watch. And it's funny because normally when a team is like undefeated and just keeps on winning and everything like that, eventually you get as an opposing fan, you get tired of that. Now you're waiting to see when they're going to fall, when's the other shoe going to drop and things start to go bad for them. But I think people realize this is a fun football team to watch. I mean, offense, defense, special teams, these guys do it all. I mean, and it's just no matter what happens. And that was a great example of it was this past Saturday against Calgary. They faced that adversity. They got dealt a bad hand. They had to eat some humble pie in that second quarter. Mm-hmm. And they could have done one of two things. They could have just let it get to them and take that first loss of the year, or they fight back and they come back and they win this game. And that's exactly what they did. And I think it's clear because all the ratings speak for themselves. I mean, everybody was tuned in because one of two things was going to happen. Either the Alouettes were finally going to lose a game, and if that's if you're an Alouettes hater, you're looking forward to that. Or if you just love good football, you're watching this team claw and scratch their way back and prove beyond the shadow of a doubt that they are who they say they are. And I think a lot of people just can't help but feel good about this Alouettes team. Jason Moss, Cody Fajardo, for how they were treated in their time in Saskatchewan, I think a lot of people still remember that. And you would think, okay, winning the Grey Cup, that sort of slays those dragons. And mm-hmm. I think by and large it did. But at the same time, they came back even more motivated this year to prove that it wasn't a fluke, that it wasn't just, they were just lucky that day. And I think a lot of people realize now that, no, the Alouettes were not just lucky that day. They were not in the right place at the right time. This team is built to win. This team is built to compete each and every week, and that's what they do. And if people are going down to injury, yeah, it sucks. Every team goes through injuries. Every team has a period where they just have a whole bunch of guys on the six-game list, and you do one of two things. You either accept it and, go in with that defeatist attitude, we're going to lose, but, it's understandable because all of our stars are hurt. Or you find out what you're made of and you go out and you do the damn thing. And that's what this Alouettes team is all about. And from day one, from when we found out guys like Wesley Sutton and Arthur Hamlin and a lot of these stars that we've become accustomed to seeing it out there. Okay, fine. Those guys are hurt. Let's see who we got going. And oh my, oh, look at this guy. And look at that guy. There's other players that have stepped up and they've been a lot of fun to watch. Not everybody's been perfect, obviously. A lot of the replacements, they've had their lumps. They've had some moments that I'm sure they'd love to have back, but that's part of the growing process. Now, where this team sits and how they've been able to overcome any adversity to date and play absolutely fun, phenomenal football that everybody is clearly watching now. Now, all the eyes are on the Alouettes. And I think they're relishing that. I think they're they've accepted the challenge of, okay, you're the man. Can you stay the man? And they're going to prove that, yes, we're going to go 1-0 this week. We're going to still prove that we are who we say we are. We are still the reigning, defending, undisputed Grey Cup champion Montreal Alouettes. Yeah. And that's what you want, especially as an Alouettes fan, a supporter. That's what you want to see. You want to see your team pick themselves up and do what they do best. And we've seen that every week thus far. And there's no reason to believe that they won't be doing that Thursday against the Toronto Argonauts as well, who they've already played and beaten quite handily, I might add. But, are they going to be able to beat them so handily this time around? I can't say yes 100%. I can't say no 100% either. But one thing is for sure, this team is going to put out the best version of themselves possible. And whatever's going to happen is going to happen. But I think you're still going to see a very entertaining football team on Thursday night.
Yeah, and one last thing before we talk about the game versus the Argonauts that came from the team is that the Members Day or Season Ticket Members Day will be occurring on July 28th, 2024 in the Esplanade on the Esplanade at the Olympic Stadium from 1:30 to 3:30. Completely different location than it was last year, obviously, because they, what stuff is happening over the annex, it can't happen there. This, I guess, no practice, and I don't know what we're going to do, but stay tuned to socials. I'm sure if you're a season ticket member, you've already received the email, and make sure you do reserve your spot. I was going into this game, Cliff versus the Toronto Argonauts, as a 6.5-point favorite. Again, this is a team that they played 2 weeks ago where they, again, the 30-20 score was a little bit, it really wasn't indicative of what the game actually was itself.
Nope.
But again, both these two teams are going into this thing a little bit banged up, have had a few changes. But again, the Alouettes are going to be playing their second straight home game. And obviously, they're going to be hopefully, despite the injuries, they're going to be able to play off the crowd on Thursday.
Yeah, definitely. And Toronto is coming in, unfortunately, on a losing streak. I mean, got their first loss of the season handed to them by these very same Alouettes. Went out to Saskatchewan and in a dogfight, got bested by the Saskatchewan Roughriders, who they themselves are really turning a lot of heads this year, much mm-hmm. like the Alouettes are. Obviously, the Argos do not want to be losers of three straight games, so you better believe they're going to be bringing everything they've got to this game. As you said, too, a lot of guys are banged up as well, but they've still got some pretty decent weapons. I'm curious, though, as to how much of Cameron Dukes we're going to see versus Nick Arbuckle or even Brian Scott.
Yeah.
Because Cameron Dukes, I mean, he was brought down to earth pretty quickly by the Alouettes at BMO Field a couple weeks ago. And, he may have learned from those mistakes. He may have, no doubt, has watched a lot of film, watched what Calgary was able to do that first half against Montreal. Mm-hmm. And probably try to replicate that as much as possible. But I think this Alouettes team, they figured him out pretty quick and made his life a living hell for those 3 hours in Toronto. Are we going to see how much of him are we going to see? And at what point, if things are going bad, at what point does Ryan Dinwiddie pull the plug on him and go to either a Nick Arbuckle or even Brian Scott, who scored the lone touchdown versus the Alouettes, be it in garbage time, but he definitely proved that he can score against the Alouettes. So I think that's going to be a very interesting matchup. I think defensively, this Montreal team, they know what they've already seen what this offense can do in Toronto. And I think this time they want to do it. They want to do the exact same thing they did at BMO Field a couple weeks ago, but now they want to do it in front of their hometown fans at Percival Molson. So I definitely think both these defenses are going to play extremely hard. As we talked about before, the Argos run defense is extremely tough. So I think as great a game Walter Fletcher had last week, will he be able to replicate that? I think he's going to be motivated enough to do that. But going up against that really tough run defense for the Argos, I think he's going to have his work cut out for him yet again. But we all know Fletch loves a challenge. So I fully expect him to maybe have a so-so first half, but then just get it figured out and then turn it on for the second half. So I think this is going to be a fun game. I just hope the weather holds up, because right now, big possibility that we could still be getting a lot of rain in Montreal over the next 24 hours. So, I mean, that could be playing a big factor in it. So
still, fingers crossed. Though another thing too that the Alouettes need to really center on is Janarian Grant. You know, he had a return, a touchdown return, a kickoff, a punt return last week for 84 yards versus Saskatchewan. Mm-hmm. He had a pretty damn good game. I think the first time that we played him in Toronto. So that's one of the other things. But you know, so far so good when it comes. We've only given up one this year, but still, one's too many. It is a part of Toronto's game that the Alouettes need to make sure that they center on.
Definitely. Once again, I think our defense is going to be tested as per usual. I mean, I know right now the depth chart just does say Marc-Antoine Decois will be playing, and if he were, that'd be fantastic. But I truly, truly believe the Alouettes are going to err on the side of caution and tell Decois not to suit for the warm-ups if you want, but you're not playing. I think they got to save him from himself a little bit.
Yeah.
Let's not forget, folks. I mean, after this game, you're basically one third of the way through the season already. What?
I know.
It feels like it just started, but already we're one third of the way of the game. You still have two thirds to go of the season, and we want Marc-Antoine Decois to be as healthy as possible. So I truly have to believe the Alouettes are going to save Marc-Antoine from himself and just tell him, no, you're not playing tonight. And again, we saw what Najee Murray is capable of doing in the secondary. You can easily slot him over there. You've got to move a couple things around to make it happen. So be it. I mean, you look at the secondary and there's a lot of stars on here, and there's a lot of different ways you can go with this. And you may get, I got a feeling they're going to get tested, especially if Decois not playing. But once again, I think this defense is truly up for the test.
Here's an interesting stat that came directly from the game notes this week. And Steve, Daniel, and the crew over there, listen to this one, Cliff. So in their last two games, obviously, you know, they're 0-2. Over their last two games, Cliff, they have only had driven for a touchdown only twice in 26 drives, but only and have 8 field goals instead. Mm. So, you know, as I said, it will be a very interesting game. It'll be a very interesting game, crowd wise, weather wise. And being able to see how these guys are able to step up and who's going to be the next man up and make sure that even if the quad doesn't play, how to keep the Alouettes, you know, be the Alouettes defense that we've come to grow and love over the past 5 games.
That's it. I stand on business when I say that this is an elite defense. I mean, maybe they didn't look so elite last week, but when the time came that they had to be, they absolutely were. And I have no doubt in my mind that if it comes to that again against Toronto this week, they will be elite again. And simply put, Cody Fajardo and Tyson Philpott right now are, can you believe those two are putting up like MOP numbers each in their own right? I mean, if this trend continues, I mean, Tyson Philpott could not just be the best Canadian receiver in the league, but the best overall receiver in the league. I mean, the numbers he's putting up are just absolutely ridiculous. And Cody has been playing outstanding football too, like really coming into his own. I talked about this. Is he elite? I still say he is very, very close. Another couple of games like he had against Calgary, for example, and earlier this year, a couple more games like that, I think you can put him in that elite category. And we could be seeing those two guys battling for most outstanding player this year. Like, who's going to be the Eastern representative for most outstanding player? And how do you choose? Like, that's going to be the fun part, is how do you choose who's going to be the MOP? I mean, Tyson Philpott would probably run away with most outstanding Canadian. If it was done today, he'd be in a landslide as far as I'm concerned. But he too can make the argument for most outstanding player. I mean, what a fun problem to have. I mean, I know it's only the first third of the season still. I mean, there's still a lot of racetrack left, but my goodness. Like, I mean, if these guys are still producing outstanding football in September, October, November, I mean, holy cow. I mean, this is a good problem to have. This is a good discussion to be having. Like, who's the MOP between Fajardo and Philpott? Or do you just make them co? I don't think the CFL awards will appreciate
that. I
was about
to say, I don't see that happening. By the way, we were talking about this earlier before and talking about next man up and needing to get the next person. Just want to at least mention is that since Maltus is now our kicker, the Alouettes needed somebody else to back him up on the practice roster since Cote is on the sixth game. And we picked up Michael Domagala. He's a kicker from Carleton, but he's played before in the CFL. He played with, was it Ottawa? And who else did he play for? I'm trying to
check. Hamilton.
Yeah. So.
In fact, if I recall, I think it was a couple of years ago during that absolutely wacky game against the Tiger Cats where it ended up going into overtime and the Alouettes ended up winning. I think it was 2021. I think it was Domagala who kicked, I think it was a close to a 50-yard field goal to tie the game and go into overtime.
Yeah.
So yeah, he knows this Alouettes team pretty well, and definitely at this point you need all the help you can get. So definitely glad to have him on board along with Anthony Federico on the defensive line. So between him and Micah Roan, who I was talking about earlier, who I was alluding to earlier, he's going to be dressing for this game against Toronto. And if he gets a chance to get in the lineup, I think you're going to see some pretty outstanding stuff from him. I mean, again, trying to keep up with Isaac Berglund, Derek Wiggin, Mustafa Johnson, Avery Ellis. I mean, you know, no small feat. There's no question about that. But if anyone could do it, I definitely think Micah has the opportunity to do it. So, I mean, if he can bring some of that energy that he had in college to a game like this, get your popcorn ready, folks. You're in for a fun night.
Yeah, exactly. And yes, even though he is on the Argos cliff, he was on the show earlier this year. We're going to make sure that we do reach out and at least say hey to John Boss.
We have to. Absolutely, we have to. I mean, again, Toronto got a really good guy.
Mm-hmm.
And in a perfect world, he'd be an Alouette. You know, and it looked like he was on board to come with us. Like, he was down to join Alouettes Nation, but unfortunately that's kind of out of his hands, out of our hands, all that stuff. But, yeah.
You know, when you don't have any number, you know, any picks in how many rounds that we had kind of does it, but anyways, it is what it is.
It is. And listen, obviously we wish the best for John as well as a member of the Argos. I mean, just not this week.
Yeah, exactly.
But yes, if we have the opportunity, we will definitely reach out and say hi to our man, John.
Yeah. Don't forget to check out our socials as we will be having our post-game show, Flight Deck Live, following the game itself. So make sure you find out when we are scheduled to go live and give us a little bit of leeway, because I know we try to do it as quickly as possible once we get there. But we want to make sure that we try to bring you guys as much information post-game that we are able to. Also, we did have a winner this week for our SportBuff Flight Crew Steed. Stay tuned in the next 2 weeks for the next drawing. When is the next home game? 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
Yep. Stay tuned for our socials. That's all you got to do. Look for our tweet and just answer the question. Simple as that. We'll choose somebody, and you'll have a chance to win those two seats for the game. So
yeah. And once again, folks, make sure like, subscribe, follow, whatever it is, however that you're a part of this, make sure you're on board 100%, because we want you to get those tickets. We want you to be on board with us. We want you to know when we're going live for Flight Deck Live. We want you to be a part of this in the worst way. So again, I say this every week, but I'll keep saying it again until everybody I know is subscribed and following and liking and all that good stuff. Make sure you're on board. I mean, you don't want to miss a moment of this. As we talked about, anything can happen when we go live, and who can crash us next? You know, for example, I mean, you never know. I mean, anything truly can happen when you go live. So make sure you don't be left out. Don't watch it the next day and say, "Oh, dang, I missed that." Like, don't be that guy. We don't want you having FOMO. Put it that way.
Exactly. Hope to see you at the game this week, everybody. Don't forget, we did find out the Owls will be wearing red, so it should be fun. We'll see which all red, partial red, what you'll have to see on TV, or hopefully we'll see at the game, obviously.
If I were to bet, I'd say all red, but
I think so too.
I mean, I think so. You never know. Maybe red jersey, blue pants. I still think that would be a cool look.
I still think that would be very nice. I do agree with you. But stay tuned for our socials, and If we don't see you for Flight Deck Live, we will see you for this show. We will see you for our next show. So for everybody here at the Alouettes Flight Deck, for Cliffy D, I'm Tim Capper. We're on Final Approach.
Take off!
Thanks for listening. Find more great shows like this at CF Pod Network on Twitter.